Welcome into the DNVR Rockies podcast brought to you by Strava Craft Coffee. Remember to use your promo code DNVR25. You'll get 25% off your entire purchase of that CBD-infused, deliciously rich, and potentially life-altering Strava Craft Coffee. I'm your host, Drew Creasman, the managing editor of DNVR Rockies. With me, as always, is beat writer Patrick Lyons. And on this episode, a little bit of previewing of the homestand. We got some interleague play coming up for you at Coors Field. Also going to play some games and have some fun, some of the ones that you're used to. But we're talking a little bit about Rockies' future. That's been a fun topic as of late. So getting sort of into the players on the field. Figure we'd talk about some of those things. And anything else that's going on out there in the world today, in the world of baseball, too. There's a lot of things. There are just things happening. It's been quite the season for things in Major League Baseball. And so we'll get around to talking about all that. Of course, hit us up with any questions if you've got, especially if you're along for the ride here on the YouTube channel. Make sure that you are joining us. By the way, if you're not subscribed to the YouTube, make sure that you are subscribed to the YouTube channel. Click that bell icon. It'll let you know when we're going live. Also, since I'm here and got a situation, we're going to make sure that you're all members of the DNVR.com. Make sure to subscribe today at the DNVR.com. All right. A couple of things. There's a couple of bits of news just to get away. We don't need much analysis of this, but the Rockies did make a couple of weird transactions. Just those things you do when you're kind of shuffling.
Puzzling transactions. Yes,
I don't. They're just moves. They're just moving guys around. I saw some people, you know, asking why Connor Joe going down. I think the obvious answer is to get at bats. He's not doing any good sitting on the Rockies bench. He'll be back, but they have to showcase CJ Cron while he's healthy for a trade. And that's all that is. You know, it's just,
I understand the frustration. No, you're not frustration, a preference, right? There's look, these moves have happened in 2017, 2018, even 2019 when they're in the playoff hunt. You go, this guy instead of that guy, and that's what makes baseball great. But yeah, ultimately, it's a series of moves. It's not make or break, and yeah, might be a little disappointing, might be frustrating. You might prefer one guy over the other, but it's not cataclysmic.
And none of it's permanent. Like none of this has.
That's true too.
Yeah, like especially these moves here right now. So I'm not going to fret too much over them, but the players around that area, right, of who's trying to prove that they can play right. Or not. I think that's where we'll spend most of our conversation. We did a recent make sure you go back and listen to our full coverage of, you know, the farm system. This will include, you know, some of those lost boys, as it were, today.
But real quick, those moves were Ben Bowden was activated from the injured list. He'll get some innings down in AAA. So he's down there. And Alan Trejo came up because if you hadn't heard, Trevor Story is on the IL. He took some grounders today at Coors Field. So, hey, so far it's been good news. And you got to hope that it stays that way. So they need another, you know, middle infielder, another option there at shortstop. So Trejo's up, which means Connor Joe needs to go down. And, of course, that leaves Matt Adams and as you said, CJ Cron behind. Two guys that don't have any options. One guy that you definitely want to showcase a little bit as a potential trade piece there in Cron. And even a guy like Matt Adams, you go, hey, that's a veteran bat that another team just goes, look, we're desperate. And so, shoot, we'll give you our 60th best prospect. And you go, hey, that was something for nothing. And guess what? Connor Joe's back up. So we kind of got to have our Connor Joe and eat it too as – The phrase now goes.
Right. I like that. So what we're going to do today is actually do a lot of combining of two games that we've played a lot of before, both Would You Rather and More Likely. And I'll start with an impromptu one about these guys. So I'll start with the more likely version of it. What's more likely, that Alan Trejo has himself a nice little major league career kind of out of nowhere, or that Connor Joe has himself a nice little major league career kind of out of nowhere?
Well, I was, you know, one of the first people on the Trejo train. The Trejo train. Because I did believe in his glove a lot and thought his bat, you know, played up a little bit. Again, at least to be for a guy who virtually was on no top 30 list ever.
Right.
You go, well, he's not even going to make the majors, or if he does, maybe when he's 27 and, you know, out of option, look, here's where he's at now. And you go, yeah, well, look at this Rockies roster and look at their record. And you go, that's okay. Guys like that will always have a job in the major leagues. If you can pick it at shortstop, then they can easily move you over to second. Freddy Galvis is still a thing in Major League Baseball and probably will be for 3 or 4 more years.
Right.
Because he can still do the damn thing. Right. Of course. Yeah. And so those guys have a lot of value. So I do think, you know, Trejo is going to have a nice little career, but I would venture to say Connor Joe could have a higher upside.
Yeah.
You know, with some of the setbacks that he's had, better pedigree, but again, at a certain point, that pedigree means nothing, right? Because maybe we'll even get to talking about the conversation around Riley Pine at this point, and goes, you say, who cares that he was the fourth overall pick? Because you're right, no one does care at this point. You can't find the strike zone. It doesn't matter how much anyone paid you out of high school, and how high the selection out of the state of Kansas. That stuff means nothing. Can you do it? And so I think Connor Joe projects as, you know, having a bit of a higher upside. Again, less opportunity for those corner infield guys and corner outfield guys, especially because at a certain point you might have to move to DH. And so there are some limitations there for that. But I think Joe is the one that's going to have that higher ceiling. So I would venture to say it's going to be him, believe it or not.
Interesting. So I would have gone the other way with this, but if you added in the would you rather, right? So what's more likely? I think, again, this is an old school baseball logic right here. Trejo has the higher floor because the defense and all that stuff is there. Like you said, the Freddy Galvis, you laid it out. That's why I think Trejo is more likely to work out a nice little career. But I think if you could wave your magic wand and say, would you rather, because Joe has the higher ceiling, you would take a Connor Joe who figures everything out, and suddenly the Rockies have this really nice, solid, at the very least, role player, if not, you know, contributor for the next couple of years, which who knows, you know, how long that'll be. But, you know, but yeah, I tend to agree with you that Joe's got the higher ceiling there. So that'll be interesting. All right. I've actually got a series of these. So let's stay in that general area. Basically, player comps. Who do you think reaches their full potential versus who would you rather reach their full potential? I'll start with this one. Dom Nuñez and Austin Gomber.
So say that, repeat that again for anyone listening so we get the specifications on this one. Dom Nuñez
Austin Gomber. Who reaches their full potential? Who do you think is more likely to max out their potential as a ball player, Gomber or Nuñez? And then the second question is, if you could just wave the magic wand and decide, which guy would you pick?
Well, I think you'd have to decide Dom Nuñez. You would, especially for this organization.
I think the magic wand answer has to be Dom Nuñez, right?
You're wanding Nuñez. Yes. you're going to wander him. He's got to be the guy, the homegrown kid. And maybe most importantly, catcher. Like, again, we're talking about an opportunity here, to have your all-time franchise player at this position. Granted, you know, we understand the bar isn't terribly high, but if you go and look at all of the expansion clubs from 93 and 98 between the Marlins, Rockies, Rays, and Diamondbacks, none of them have had any of those big name guys. There's no one that really contributed to any of them. We know Pudge Rodriguez was with the Marlins in 2003, but really career all-time guys, those numbers don't really do much. Hey, Charles Johnson did a lot for the Marlins. Yeah, well, he did it for a little bit for the Rockies, but really that's not setting the bar terribly high. So you so understand that.
Charles Johnson was a Rocky.
You understand that, but at the same time, you still go, yeah, that's what you want to see. We already had two left-handers get Cy Young Award votes for this organization. Don't think we forgot about you, Jeff Francis. Of course, the other being Kyle Freeland. But yeah, you'd have to make the magic wand over Dom Nuñez and hope that he's got the longer career. He's got a little bit more control also before he hits free agency. So you've got that element, left-handed bat. That's fantastic. But I would actually, in the first part of the question was, you know, who has the better career, who has the longer career? I actually think it or who hits that ceiling, right? I actually think it could be Austin Gomber. I think it will be him. You know, Nuñez is struggling right now. I think even, you know, if you would have asked this question mid-April, it would have been a dead heat.
It would have been Gomber, right?
Because Gomber, his value is kind of on the lower side. He was still walking guys and was still, you know, getting hit a little bit, not giving up too many homers, but, you know, getting knocked around a little bit. Nuñez does 5 home runs in that the first 3 weeks, and you go, whoa, this kid's got something. But now I think a little more time has settled in. I feel pretty confident that it is, you know, going to be Austin Gomber with his ability to be effective as a fly ball pitcher at Coors Field. You go, what? Well, if you can do that here, you're going to be able to do that just about anywhere. And so he does have a lot of that polish. But, you know, if you're a left-handed hitting catcher, you can have a very long career, very profitable career in the major leagues at, you know, 36, 37. Look at Stephen Vogt. I mean, he's still getting $2, $3 million a year just to stick around as a number two catcher. That's not a bad gig. I mean, your poor kneecaps. But other than that, it's not a bad gig. But I think for ceiling, I'm more inclined to think that maybe Gomber could get a taste of an all-star game, a bid or selection, maybe more so than Dom.
Yeah. I'm with you there. This is, I have the same answer.
Oh, okay. I'm a little surprised by that. Okay.
I'm with you. I think Dom's just like, look, Dom's got a bigger mountain to climb. Sure. And he's not as further along in the journey, as much as I've been a long time believer in his, and, you know, and I see the improvement in different areas. And, you know, we talk about, he's in this major slump at the plate now. But he's been really improving behind the dish in a lot of little things that I'm seeing. And he still needs to be getting better at those, but he is. Remember, he's his first full year in Major League Baseball. You would have to be getting better at these things. So I still think he's got a better chance to get there than I think most people would assume, especially, again, if we're going off of the recency bias of right now, he's in a pretty bad funk. He's striking out on, you know, pitches right down the middle and stuff. But I'm with you. I think that Gomber has all the pedigree, all the stuff there, and is already starting to put together things that pitchers don't usually do their first full year as starters. He's got an advanced mind and feel for pitching on top of 4 above average pitches. That's just what makes a good pitcher. You know, the only variable in all of that is how will he respond to Coors Field? And so far he's been doing a pretty damn good job with it. So I would agree with you there. It's funny. MLB The Show does these like updates based on how players have been doing throughout the season. And they've completely not noticed Ryan McMahon at all whatsoever. Like, wow. No upgrade there, no upgrade for him. Especially defensively, that's been strange. They have noticed how terrible the Rockies bullpen is. Guys like Michael Gibbons and Daniel Bard have had all of their ratings come down. But the one guy that has taken a huge jump forward, he started out as a 71 and is now rated as a 77 this year, is, and he's with John Gray now. They're both 77.
That's a big leap.
Ratings.
That's a big leap.
It was Austin Gomber. Yeah. And it's all based on, you know, they go in and look at all the StatCast stuff and all the, you know, ERA plus, which is now above league average, those kinds of things. And it's just, he's already starting to be there. So it's, you know, he's got a long, they've both got a long way to go to improve for sure. But I'm with you. Gomber's already doing some very interesting things.
I like the aspect of one guy's a pitcher, one guy's a hitter, a catcher, right? They're battery mates. They're both lefties.
Right.
That's a good comparison. That makes it a little bit tricky to try to figure out, but I'm surprised we're on the same page. That's good.
Yeah. I think we'll differ on a few of these other ones, but first I'm still drinking my Strava Craft coffee. I'm still on Strava hours for me, but grab your Breck Seltzers or your Breck Brews out there if you've got them handy. If you don't, go down to the liquor store, to King Supers. You can always swing by the DNVR bar. As I mentioned earlier, when you become a member, you get a bigger one down there. All kinds of fantastic perks for being a member, including getting all of that delicious Breck Brew goodness and getting hooked up with some of our fantastic friends like the people at Gabby Insurance, who just help you save money. Check them out, gabi.com/DNVR. Take you less than 10 minutes. You're probably paying way too much for your home and car insurance. I was paying about $480 a year too much for just car insurance. Our guy Eric Weedham was paying over $1,000 too much on all the things that he has insured. So check them out. It costs you nothing, just a tiny little bit of time. There's no text messages, emails, none of that garbage. You just get to save money. Again, it's gabi.com/DNVR for your absolutely free check to see how much money you can save. Oh, I love Ken with an old school comp here in the comments going Brian Bohannon. Minus about 45 pounds, but yeah, love a big boy, Brian Bohannon comp, but yeah, they've got a similar pitching style, the big loopy curveball, and it'd be interesting. We should look up some mechanics stuff and see what we can find on Brian Bohannon. Like
dude had some decent spells with the Rockies, yeah, that really a couple underrated. There's, you know, in the years past when we've done those off-season deep dives into statistics and who's had the best, and like Gabe White, what? Oh, okay, cool. Like Brian Bohannon's been on, you know, a couple of those lists, and a guy who was signed as a free agent, and you know, sure, you know, his ERA was incredibly high, but he had those moments for a guy. In fact, well, I'll just mention this real quick. In 99, he was 12-12, had a 6.20 ERA, and you go, yeah, well, that was the time. Zip, zip. 3.1 wins above replacement.
Boom.
So
how many innings did he pick up? Goodness gracious.
Like, right? You go, wait. What? I mean, maybe that's league average for Coors Field. I don't know. Yeah, 197 innings pitched. It's a lot. 33 starts. You know, back when guys were in them all. Only struck out 120 guys.
How interesting.
You know what his whip was? Go ahead. What do you think his whip was?
If his ERA was 6+ and all that, I'm going to say 1.42.
1.662.
Goodness gracious.
3.1 wins above replacement. Folks, we have no idea what wins above replacement means. No. I know it's great and all.
Let's get Ryan Bohannon on the phone.
And I'm not trying to totally blow up sabermetrics, but I think based on what we know now, this is what we have. I think it's really good. But man, when the next generation comes, whatever that looks like, whatever they're able to figure out, I don't know if they can put in old VHS tapes and like retroactively do Statcast and try to do value on that. We're going to find out there's been some legendary Rockies players that did some legendary things right under our noses and we had no idea.
I had no idea. I've got a theory for you.
Austin theory?
Of the war. From Dante Bichette's 1995 season was somehow and in some way subtracted from him and his defense and put onto Brian Bohannon in 1999. It's the only thing that makes sense.
That's not just a theory. That's a conspiracy theory. Yeah. The Lord of Sabermetrics, whoever that person is, or whoever right. that conglomeration of, you know, heavenly bodies, whatever they might be, that made that right. decision. They go, well, we got to give this extra war to somebody. It was Brian Bohannon in 1999.
Ended up with the extra war. Hey, we got this leftover war. Anybody need some war?
Poor Dante.
That is absolutely bizarre. I'm going to look into that further.
Thanks for sidetracking us there, buddy.
Manny. We got to give Manny like our top five, like WTF. Like what? I know he studied the Dante Bichette thing, so we don't need to give him that one again. But like this, like what? All right. Another two players and another potential battery mates. I don't think they've done it yet, but a catcher-pitcher combo. Further back in the Rockies system, neither of these guys have debuted yet. Same thing. So let's start with more likely to reach their full potential. I think we're both going to agree on that part here, but the magic wand will be interesting. So Drew Romo or Chris McMahon.
All right. Higher ceiling?
Yeah. So which one of these guys has the higher ceiling, and then which one of them is more likely to reach it?
So I'm going to say easily Chris McMahon. For the simple fact of, before I even think about Drew Romo as a human being or a baseball player, and Chris McMahon as a human being / baseball player, he's both of those things simultaneously. The track record of high school catchers in the first or second round in the last decade plus is not good. It's just not good. And so I hope Drew Romo breaks that mold and goes against the grain and is that exception to the rule, so to speak, right? And so it's really for that reason that I got to go.
Magic wand. Yeah.
With a magic wand, I would actually – my magic – I would wander Romo.
You would wander Romo?
Okay. I wouldn't wander Franco. I would wander Romo because, again, you got the catching issue there, right? You got a good young kid. You want to see the – and you want him to get good right at that right time when you know, he's going to be coming up when the next group of guys, whoever they are, however the Rockies get themselves back there by hook or by crook, whether by tanking or just doing what they've been doing – in 5 years, everything's going to regenerate. Romo's going to be there in time, maybe in his rookie season, second season, third season, depending on how fast he comes up. That's right. The guy that you want, and you got to figure there's going to be enough other arms in the organization that are going to, you know, end up developing nicely, because the Rockies have been doing such a good job with that you don't need McMahon. But in the reality world, I would put my money on Chris McMahon, who's already been doing really nicely so far.
Yeah, I agree with you again on both these. I thought I might trip you up on the Romo one with the magic wand. And the other thing that's kind of hilarious about this too is that I think it's why I put the catchers on there. If you were to go with almost anybody other than Zach Veen, I guess, to reach his full potential, you want Zach Veen to reach his full potential because he's got extraordinary potential. Anybody else, you're taking a pitcher. Most of the time for the Rockies, for this organization, but the catchers are where you can maybe trip because you're like, oh, only one catcher. Like you talked about the franchise's history with it. You could do so much at that position to have a potential outcome on the game. But it's funny. It's like, what do they really, as we've talked about so many times, what does the future, what should the now, what should the teams be built around? Really good pitching. And so, you know, waving the magic wand for Chris McMahon feels like, in some ways, it makes sense, right? It would make perfect sense to do that for him or Helcris Oliveras or Ryan Rolison or any of these guys, right?
Yeah, that you're right. You make a great point because this would be one where if we go back and look, and I've been trying to keep tabs on all of our little, you know, would you rather or more likely to, so we can go back and look at them at various points. But you're absolutely right. This would be one where in 3 years' time, you're going, oh, it should have been McMahon, right? Because again, the Rockies have so much money to spend that you go, there's no way they're going to lose everybody, right? They can't. But in 3 years' time, almost everyone could be gone, including McMahon and Tapia and the pitchers, like, and right. Story. They could all be gone and you go, oh, crap. Chris McMahon's the guy. It's like, you don't need Nuñez and Romo. Even if Romo is only, you know, half of what they hope for him to be, you don't need both of those guys.
Right.
So McMahon could be the guy that you went, no, that was the one that we needed. We need a new ace of the staff for whatever reason. But you're right. You still got Rolison. You still got Helcris Oliveras coming through the pipeline. Carl Crawford's now at AA. So maybe it'll be all right. But it's going to be hard for the next group of starting pitchers to do what this current group is doing. This foursome that they have now.
Right.
And then there's been other guys that's been the number five, whether it was Chad Bettis for a minute, whether it was Tyler Anderson for a minute, that have come in and now it's Austin Gomber, like that have been this, you know, wave of fresh air through the organization that you thought they would never get to. And it could be gone like that. And you go, oh man, that was the golden age. That was a golden era of Rockies pitching, and they might not have it again. So careful what you want for.
Yeah, exactly, right? See, you may have to wand on a couple of these pitchers. It's like, do we already wand Nuñez? Because if we already wanded Nuñez, we don't need a wand Romo. We can want no, only one wand. But they're going to need some of these pitchers to pan out and or to keep some of the guys they've got for even longer. Even like you mentioned, like even Marquez's extension would need to be extended or, you know, figure out things with Freeland and Gray and all those guys, because otherwise 3 years time when they should be building it up again and all these guys coming up, they're going to need the pitching. All right. So let me do this one then, and then we'll move away from the Rockies and do some more Major League Baseball style ones. So this one is really just, I think, a would you rather. I guess we could predict what they'll do, but it's hard to know about next year's draft. We don't even know what position they're going to have. So again, we're kind of predicting different. So I would say, would you rather the Rockies get one superstar pitcher in the draft, but mostly nothing else? Let's say Elijah Green, right? Let's assume Elijah Green, and you know, and he is as advertised or whatever, but you know, so he's a real star pitcher. But then really nothing else of the draft, maybe a bench player who shows up in 5 years, but nothing else. Or they've no real star talent, but they get 5, 6, 7 guys who can be contributors 3 or 4 years down the line.
That's a good question. I think the answer that, you know, most GMs and most front office executives would give is that you would probably prefer the superstar. You'd rather get the one guy, because those are the guys that don't grow on trees. Those are the guys you can't get in free agency. And yeah, I know we're talking about the Rockies and they can't really get much of anything in free agency, but we don't necessarily think that's going to happen, right? But you could also say, hey, they go out and try to sign a superstar player, that you could see that falling apart too, just because of, you know, the randomness and the difficulty guys have playing at Coors Field. So I think you take the superstar and say, all right, we'll figure it out with trades. I mean, Germán Márquez isn't quite a superstar, but they were able to go and steal him in a deal, and they still were able to get, you know, a couple a good seasons out of Jake McGee, or at least the one before they signed him in free agency. Yeah. So you take the superstar guy, because those are the ones that you can't necessarily get, and you can't even necessarily get him sign them as a free agent. You know, that's something that really, you know, ceased to exist in the past decade, where guys. So teams started really recognizing, you know what, let's give these guys guaranteed money now in their third or fourth year, because they're about to be a superstar, and we'll buy out some of their free agency. So now, you know, guys aren't becoming free agents at 27 years old. Like, yeah, I know we just saw that with Manny Machado and Bryce Harper, but they've been the exceptions to the rule. Like, all of those great players just aren't getting there. There's this great shortstop class that's coming about. And I wrote an article this offseason and say, hey, there's a game within the game for the Rockies. How do they deal with their superstar shortstop, you know, issue, so to speak, right? Cleveland moved already. They got rid of Francisco Lindor. Signed an extension with the Mets. So that's one less guy that's a superstar that you think you're going to get in free agency. You're not going to get. So you just can't get superstars. So it's for that reason you take that, and you've got to figure something else out in trades. Hope that the year before and after in the draft, you go and you can get some more of those part-time players, if you will, or those bit players that are just pretty good, even if they don't even become all-stars. There's just you just figure it out. An organizational guy, whatever it is, you just can't get those superstar guys. They don't grow on trees.
Yeah,
got to get that one.
Yeah,
don't agree with me.
Here's the thing.
You do. Okay, that's fine.
I do actually, and it's funny because it's so antithetical to where I normally stand on, like, you got to get quantity. You've got to get a whole bunch of guys, especially for the Rockies. Like,
I love quantity.
Like, guys get hurt. Guys don't pan out. But again, we're sort of assuming this guy's going to pan out. But the things can go wrong, right? And also, you just need a bunch of dudes. You need depth, especially here and in baseball in general. That said, Yeah, you got to get the superstar. You got to get the superstar. I was going back. We did on TDSP a couple of weeks ago. We did this whole thing about just the best drafts for each team in their history. And, you know, you can go through and you can find these years where the Broncos or the Nuggets or the Rockies found four or five solid contributors. And you go, man, solid draft. They hit on like four or five picks. And, you know, but then all the best drafts, like what was the Broncos' best draft? When they got John Elway. That was the Broncos' best draft, when they drafted John Elway. Who else did they draft that draft? Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And it's kind of similar to the Rockies. Like there were a few years where they got a few guys, but their best draft was when they got Nolan Arenado. That was the draft that most dramatically shifted their franchise, is when they ended up with Nolan. And they didn't know it was going to be, and nobody knew that pick was going to be the pick that it was, because he was taken like in the sandwich round. But still, I'm with you there. I was so prepared to go the other way and say like, because you can rebuild a whole farm system, right? All this talk of where your farm system's rated. The Rockies had one of the worst rated farm systems in baseball. Then they drafted Zach Veen, and guess what? Still one of the worst, because one guy does not a farm system make, right? But that said, yeah. And Will, I know they traded John Elway.
We know it was the Colts.
If you want to go back and listen to that whole argument on that show, you can find that TDSB.
The year that they got John Elway when he became available via the draft. You know what? In 2017, even 2018, maybe even in 2019, our answer would have been, give me the quantity.
Yeah.
Because you got a superstar in Nolan Arenado.
Yeah.
You got a superstar in Trevor Story.
No.
You got a budding superstar in Germán Márquez, who's still budding. And you go, you know what? Those five, six, seven big leaguers, right, that you're going to get in that draft. Well, guess what? Not all of them are going to end up appearing in their first major league game as a Rockies player, because you're going to use them as trade chips to help continue keep the window of contention open longer. But right now, as it stands, yeah, you do want that superstar. It's one of the reasons why, you know, the Dodgers have, you know, in a sense have been able to sustain the way they've been. You go, well, their draft pick is always in the 20s. Well, they don't need to get superstars. They just need to get these pieces and then go out and trade for them like they did with Manny Machado a couple of years ago. You know, you can do those kind of things. So it really does depend on what you need at various times. And right now the Rockies, they need their next superstar, because right now it's going to be Ryan McMahon. And we see it. And you hope maybe Trevor Story can stick around. They got enough money to do it. Are they going to, you know, pull that trigger and offer him enough to stay around? And even if they do offer him enough, does Trevor Story take it? You don't know. So, hey, you know what? If you can get a superstar in a draft, you absolutely have to take that guy.
Yeah. Yep. Sadly, I agree with you once again. We're going to move
over. Sadly for the show, or just you don't like it? No.
All right, so going to sink our teeth into a little bit of MLB talk. Actually, we'll have a transition one that's still related to the Rockies, and then we'll talk about a few other teams out there doing some interesting things. And then after that, I'm going to sink my teeth into some Hassle Cattle Company Wagyu beef. Sure. One of my favorite things to eat. We got ground chuck, ground beef, bacon, award-winning hamburgers, steaks. It's absolutely delicious. And the best thing about it is that in addition to being really, really good, it's also good for everyone involved. Good for the animals. They don't shoot them up with all those hormones and antibiotics and garbage. It's good for your wallet, because you can get promo deals there that make it so that it's actually cheaper than buying beef at the grocery store, which is filled with garbage and is not nearly as tasty. And you can get free shipping when you order over $200 and 10% off when you use promo code DNVR10. If you follow a friend, Nighthawk, big friend of the podcast, Kristen, she's out there on Twitter posting her delicious looking concoctions with the Wagyu beef. I'll post mine every once in a while. I'm nowhere near as good as she is, but it's basically foolproof. You can make delicious beef, even if you're not the most knowledgeable cook. Check them out again today at Hassle Cattle Company. It's HASSELL cattlecompany.com. And don't forget to use that promo code DNVR10 to get 10% off. Also, Make sure that you're checking out our friends at the DraftKings Sportsbook. You know, it makes watching sports a whole lot more fun, and it certainly makes it a whole lot more profitable than it would have been if you weren't doing it. I love watching along with, as I've mentioned, I like to bet on the home run for the game. That makes that guy's at bats throughout the game that much more interesting. Maybe who's going to get a hit, strikeout over unders, run over unders. I feel like we haven't always been great on, those individual ones, but I feel like our over unders on runs this year have been pretty good. We've been pretty good at nabbing the, especially when we're taking the unders in total runs in Rockies games. We should do a study on that sometime. I'll bet.
We've nailed that every time that we've gone under, as strange as that is.
Yeah. The public always thinks that the Rockies are going to either score more or give up more runs, slightly more than they actually do. I think that's a solid bet. But whichever ones of those things you're looking at, just make sure you've got that downloaded. The top-rated DraftKings Sportsbook app now. Use promo code DNVR when you sign up to turn $1 into $100 in free credits when you bet on the basketball team of your choice to win their next game. That's right, it's only $1. So you don't have to know that much about the NBA. Just sign up, throw a buck that way. Hey, they won. I got $100 in free credits. Awesome. Promo code DNVR for a limited time only at DraftKings Sportsbook. Must be 21 or older, Colorado only, new customers only. Wager paid out in site credits. Restrictions apply. See DraftKings.com/sportsbook for details. And if you have a gambling problem, call 1-800-522-4700.
Well, instead of making you wait for some point later on in the week, let's make some money today. My DraftKings Sportsbook pick of the week, Adolis Garcia, yes, of the Texas Rangers, to homer tonight against your Rockies. It doesn't matter because the Rockies are still favorite. They're minus 175 with Germán Márquez on the hill against the Rangers, who have lost 12 road games in a row. Hey, that's right. The Rockies are home. They are a completely different team at home. Rangers are struggling, to say the least. But Adolis Garcia, the latest Cuban sensation, the latest former Cardinals outfielder, Cuban sensation, Adolis Garcia, he leads baseball right now with 16 homers. Already has 41 RBI and hit 11 homers so far in the month of May. We flip the calendar. He's on the road. I'm not too worried about his play on the road. He did hit 3 home runs in a series against Houston the last time that they were away from Globe Life Park. So I think he's owed me a lock today. Plus 405 for the guy leading MLB to hit a home run at Coors Field. What? Yes. Plus 405. That's my DraftKings Sportsbook pick of the week. Adolis Garcia, plus 405 to homer tonight at Coors Field.
Boom. That'd be a big win. So you got Chelsea. Did your guy score the goal though? I saw it was a 1-0 game, right?
No. Yes. Chelsea won. Yeah. They pulled it off. They pulled the upset. That was plus 365, I think.
Yeah.
So I was stoked.
Yeah, but your guy didn't get the goal. That would have been big.
Christian Pulisic did not do the thing. Okay. But it was funny enough because in a weird random chance, I ran into a guy running trails in Boulder, my favorite spot, the Tasso Preserve. Check that out. He happened to be from Iran, but he's a professor at CU, and he was showing his friend from Germany around. We got to talking about soccer, and he's like leasing out a place of his in Germany where he also used to live to an American kid who's on Bayern Munich's second team. So it was like, look at that. We still got Americans playing in Europe, doing the damn thing. So it's one of those great coincidences that can only happen in Colorado.
Right. All right. I've got an updated one for you that'll move us from Rockies. It's half Rockies, half MLB talk, and then we'll do a little more MLB talk. But we did this one once before with Makayla, but I'm going to move the goalposts a little bit on either side of the same question. So before we had Rockies lose 100 games or a team that hasn't won since the Rockies became a team wins the World Series. Now we're going to move that a little bit. The Rockies lose 105.
Ooh.
Or a team, and then we're moving the World Series just a couple of years later to 96, which gives us a nice 25 year in the last 25 years, 96 to 2021. So the two extras that you could include.
The Blue Jays.
And the Braves. That's the one that, so yeah, what's more likely, the Rockies lose 105 games or a team that has not won the World Series since the 1996 season wins the World Series this year. And for those listening, while Patrick's thinking about it, for those listening, I have the teams that are not. So you can't have the Yankees, the Red Sox, the Giants, the Cardinals, the Marlins, the Diamondbacks, the Angels, the White Sox, the Phillies, the Nationals, the Cubs, the Royals, the Astros, and I guess the Dodgers. Technically.
I think I'd be inclined to take the field. It's more, I mean, I haven't recalculated to see how many losses I think the Rockies will get, if it's going to be 105 or not. It may be close, you know, it may be that, but just the general idea of the fact that, you know, I was thinking about this today, cause I think that's such an interesting statistic where you go, oh, you know, only, nine teams have won the World Series, I think, since 93. Is that right?
No. 15 have won since 93. Only 9 have won since 2003. And
oh, that's right. Yeah. That's who won it. But if you back off and you just say make it to the World Series, then at that point you got a 50-50 shot. So you like those odds. So I think there's a better chance that someone who hasn't won it yet is going to do so, just because again, I like that crop. You know, Toronto doesn't necessarily do that too much for me. Atlanta was a team that I did pick to win the NL East. You know, Tampa is still out there, is a big one. So I'd be more inclined to take the field because I'm essentially getting a 50-50 shot with all those teams. And okay, well, the Rockies are one of those teams. All right, so maybe it's 48%. But that's what you get when you play roulette at a casino. You know what I mean? The house has that, so it's not exactly 50-50. It's more like 48% because the Rockies are in that group. But I think there's a good chance of that. And you know what? The Rockies are bad on the road. They're not great at home. They've been better than 500. I think they're going to struggle, but you know, 105 is another step past 100. And again, they can, you know, here's something that I was going to maybe write about tonight for tomorrow. Of all of the teams that have had, what is it? I want to say a 283 winning percentage on the road. So basically won 22 or less games on the road, 22 mm-hmm. of their 81 games, right? So that's 22 and 59. Of all of the teams who have done that, there's been about 40 different instances of teams with that winning percentage or less.
Right.
Only one of them did not lose 100 games. So it's like there's a 95% chance that if the Rockies, you know, win 22 or less games, there's about 90-95% chance that they're going to lose 100 games. Except when you consider, and I don't know if this means anything, Drew. I don't know if this means anything, but that one team that lost 22 or less, or that won 22 or less games on the road, was the 2014 Colorado Rockies, who did not lose 100 games.
There you have it.
Does that mean something? Is that a small sample size? Is that a coincidence? I don't know what it means.
I don't know what any of that means, but it's interesting. It's fascinating.
It's more important that I think it's more important that it's a majority of the time, an overwhelming majority, that if you're that bad on the road, you just can't overcome that at home and you're going to lose 100 games. It just so happened that the one time it didn't happen, it was the same franchise. It's crazy.
Did you happen to see the new Fangraphs projections that came out? I don't know if it was this morning.
No.
Do you want to guess how many losses they have the Rockies at?
Oh, well, if it's Fangraphs, 109.
No, it really surprised me. I was kind of shocked. But I think they're overvaluing run differential in some ways.
The run differential has been somewhat favorable for
the Rockies. That's right. So they actually have them at 99 losses, exactly what you and I were talking about last time, where it was, will they have their worst ever or will they get to 100? And I said, can I pick 99 exactly? That's what Fangraphs has them at. So I feel like,
interesting.
I feel like it's going to be in that neighborhood, but yeah.
And what's their percentage to make the playoffs? 0.0%? 0.001?
I don't know that they've eliminated them yet or not, but
yeah.
But go ahead. You're probably fine. All right. I want to move us over to the American League now for just a minute and talk about some interesting places, because the Colorado Rockies are not the only team that's really been eating it lately, but the Yankees weren't necessarily expected to be eating it the way they have been. They gained their footing for a little bit, but right now, in the standings in the American League, and I think actually your Chicago White Sox, do they still have the best record? No, the Rays have overtaken them for the best record in baseball.
They've been fantastic.
Again, a team that people have, you know, we're all kind of sleeping on after they got rid of Blake Snell and a few other guys in the offseason. But who's the other big one?
I don't know if Makayla had them in the playoffs. I know you did, yeah. I did. But yeah, they're playing, you know, fantastically. I mean, you'd have to say better than anyone could have imagined, especially when losing their ace. But and Charlie Morton too. Don't forget about him.
Yeah.
But yeah, the Yankees are scrapping a little bit. And even as bad as they've been playing, losing four in a row, still four games over 500. Toronto is now moving into their second home away from home in Buffalo. So they're going to Salem Field that's been refurbished a little bit, but. Yeah, White Sox playing well. You had Oakland, and so did Makayla in the AL West. I had Houston. Houston's only half came back. That's an interesting matchup. And we'll see Oakland this weekend at Coors Field. That'll be exciting.
Because that's one of those random teams. You know how you feel like there are certain teams the Rockies just never play well against? The A's, for whatever reason, have always been a team I feel like they've always played well against, regardless, even when they're good. So we'll... That'll be fun. It's one of those random ass things. Like the Marlins were one of those teams that the Rockies would always play terrible against, just for no, even when they were awful. I feel like the A's are the flip side of that.
It's interesting that you brought up the Marlins, because I was going to ask a question, and this is, there's a fantastic baseball podcast that I listen to. I'm glad to give them a plug, because they go down the rabbit hole. It's called Effectively Wild. It's a Fangraphs podcast. Yeah. Effectively Wild. And I feel like this would be a question for them of like, if MLB had to showcase their game for the world and it was just aesthetics, right? You might pick Coors Field a little bit for the view of the mountains and everything. And, you know, you just saw what PNC Park looked like with Roberto Clemente, the bridge that was in the background. But as far as teams that you'd want to play against each other, I feel like A's and Rockies would have to be at the top of that list, especially if they could wear their colors.
Yeah.
You know, wearing purple, you know, Rockies have to bring out a purple uniform to really make that pop. And then you've got, you know, A's could go green or they could go gold.
Yeah.
Either one. You'd want those two colors to represent baseball. It's like, oh, that's really eye-catching. I'm interested in that. Marlins would be the third. Would be a third option to throw in there and go, oh wow, this is my sensories are really lighting up. This is very pleasing aesthetically.
Yeah, I'm 100% with you. And the White Sox, by the way, with those new unis, talking about aesthetically pleasing, those actually look dope. We've been harsh on some of those hats were terrible and they got pulled. So
yes,
new unis.
They're sitting in a factory somewhere.
The White Sox, who have become my number two team on MLB The Show, even though I gave you a hard time for being so high on them, but still it's an easy group to love and get into. Still out there doing their thing, leading the AL Central. Here's your more likely. What's more likely? The White Sox win the American League pennant, or the Yankees miss the postseason altogether? As you mentioned, the Yankees are over 500, but they're also there in that division with the Rays and the Red Sox and the Blue Jays, who are all over 500.
I've already been accused of picking on the Yankees, but I got to say what I think. I got to say what my brain is telling me to say. I think it's probably more likely that the Yankees miss the postseason than the White Sox win the AL pennant. I had a lot of concerns about the Yankees starting pitching to start the season, and then it got great, and then Kluber pitched great. He's now on the IL. Jameson Taillon still trying to figure it out. You know, I think they're going to go out and try to get a piece for the starting rotation still, and that's going to help them out. But you know, the Red Sox, I don't see them continuing to play as I don't know how they're doing it. They're getting it done right now, Tampa, okay. Yeah, they can win the East. Sure. So, you know, with there being two wild cards, you know, I changed my answer.
I was going to say anything.
Now I think about it.
Dude, look at that starting rotation that you were selling me on in the offseason that I just wasn't listening to you about. I was like, Carlos Rodon is a nice little piece. It's the fifth rotation starter, guys. What even the hell? Lance Lynn on down the list with these guys. I mean, that's just, it's too much pitching.
The Yankees just have to make the postseason. And so if they get a wild card, they get knocked out after one game. That's fine. I could see them kind of squeaking in.
They
more
that little thing, right?
I have to flip that. Yeah, I would say it's more likely that the White Sox don't win the pennant then, because you know, someone else steps up. The Tony La Russa.
I was gonna say we haven't mentioned the postseason that
ends up pouring antifreeze in the engine and where the oil's supposed to go, and it's like, no, you've got this all wrong, and eventually the wheels fall off that thing. I think they're gonna be okay, even with TLR at the helm.
Conferences a day for Tony La Russa.
Yeah, yeah. The Yankees are just they're a little bipolar. You know what I mean? And I should
yeah,
you know, not use that word lightly, but I think they're going to figure out. They're going to get hot, they're going to get cold, and they're going to be frustrating, but they'll figure out a way. They've got enough pieces there to get it done. And they're going to continue to acquire because they got a good enough farm system.
They've got good farm, and they've got endless resources. They'll find a way to get themselves into it, I think. That said, Tony La Russa.
TLR, yeah, they may have to go back begging to old Rick Renteria and say, please take this job back. But then again, every time someone has come in Chicago, well, by every time, I mean one other time, someone has come in and taken Renteria's job, they did win a World Series. It happened with Joe Maddon.
True.
Took them a year to do it. So maybe another legendary skipper.
So annoying.
Yeah, poor guy.
You're entering, you're like, what? I was doing fine.
He's quickly becoming the Buck Showalter of this generation, because
totally
Buck Showalter was the manager of the Yankees through, I think it was 95. Joe Torre comes on, boom, they end up winning the World Series in 96. Then he ends up going to the Diamondbacks. He's their first manager. Nothing happens. They finally end up going. I think Bob Brindley was the manager there. Manager of Texas, he's ousted, and then they go to back-to-back World Series. They didn't get the job done, unfortunately, with Ron Washington as the manager. But Rick Renteria is now the guy where you bring him in, he won't win you a World Series, but the next guy will.
Right. All right, last one, and this is a big one, and it's both a would you rather and a more likely. It's for Major League Baseball. Overall, so we'll start with the more likely. Major League Baseball, and you can define this however you want, because we might have different definitions too, fixes its economy, but in the collective bargaining agreement, essentially, whatever you would define. Now, I think I have bigger problems with the MLB economy than you do, but generally speaking, right? And again, defined however you want, Major League Baseball fixes its what I would call fun problem. It's culture, fun, youth, energy, resistance.
Wow. Wow, that's a good question. It's hard because, as you said, like, how do you define that economy and what's fair for players? You know, shoot, Francisco Lindor making over $300 million. There are people going, well, that's not fair. Put that money back in the pocket of the owner. And that's yeah, not necessarily what we're talking about. But I think that it's more likely that they figure out the fun factor. I think they figure that element out a little bit more. You know, I know Theo Epstein recently said he's now working with the commissioner's office there and Rob Manfred, and just said, yeah, we got to put the game back in the players' hands, and we got to, you know, make it a little bit more fun, and we got to let the players lead and give them more power. You know, that's something that the NBA was able to do, and made, you know, the NBA made their players the stars. And sure, yeah, that brought about certain issues with, you know, the big three and every other big three that has come after. But I don't think that's hurting the NBA necessarily. Right. I'm sure there are those markets out there, and I'd love to get Adam Mares on to kind of break that down, because there are probably some unlucky markets that they have yet to have their big three and say, hey, when's our turn to cash in on this idea? But for the most part, I think the fun factor is coming back, and it's been good. We haven't seen as many, you know, brawls. I mean, Fernando Tatis still has his head attached after everything you've seen. So I think the game is, you know, adapting. You're going to have those hiccups, and you're going to have those old timers coming out and taking umbrage with these flashy young guys. But I think for the most part, that's starting to change. And I don't know if MLB can perfect it and get it all the way where it needs to be, where there are players that, you know, have their own channel, like a Trevor Bauer. They might not be able to go that far, but I think they're definitely taking those steps, and there have been those inroads that I think it might be more likely like that happens, especially when you consider that, you know, there, I still think that we may have a work stoppage going into next year. It's quieted down, and things seem to be a little bit better, and everything's going well. But I still think the owners are, or at least they've been losing some money. So I could see a scenario where instead of, you know, we don't start the 2022 season on June 1st. Maybe it's May 1st. I think there's still some chance about that. I think everyone's kind of waiting in the weeds a little bit. We don't necessarily know. It seems really good. Yeah. Seems really good right now.
No one's saying anything right now.
Yeah, I know. I'm still fearful, right? It's like, you know what, if no news has come about to make me change my mind, then I got to stick with what I had thought, you know, this past off season, with the player saying, no, sorry, the first domino is toppled over. So we're reporting to camp, and we're going into these stadiums. And if only 8,000 people are allowed in there, and you make, you know, you're losing money every time we play at home until we get to the summer, so be it. And the owners, I think, are going to eventually say, all right, well, we got to reclaim some of that money. So, you know, we're going to play, you know, some less games next year, or we're going to have a more condensed schedule. So we're not going to really play until May, when it gets a little bit warmer and we get those early season games out of the way, where we're only at, you know, 50% capacity because it's still cold out. I do still worry about that. So it's for that reason I go with option B, the fun factor. They figure that part out.
Yeah, I think. Again, I think you're right. I think they're more likely to. The one thing that's funny is it's like there's kind of a deadline. There's almost like a, I hate using this phrase, but I can't think of any, the proverbial gun to the head, right? Where the two sides have to figure out something with the economy. They have to figure, because like you said, if they don't, there will be a work stoppage, and the fans are going to be very angry about that.
Very.
As we know, has happened before. And so there's almost like more of an incentive for them to get that done.
True.
But even then, I don't see the solution necessarily meeting what my definition would be of having fixed the economy. You know, I'm not sure that the sides have it within them to move the league forward right now. I think they're really just, the next CBA is going to be about trying to put something together so that they can have a few years. Like, I really don't think it's going to be about creating new fun, great ideas, or fixing some of these things, or creating more parity in the league, or, you know, trying to address some of the issues about tanking, though I do think there's going to be some interesting conversation about that. Maybe a salary floor. All those things are going to be on the table. It's just, when you get enough lawyers in the room, the solutions to those questions usually end up just being annoying. So I will say, I think you're right. I've been encouraged by some of the stuff that Theo Epstein and his group has done. And I think, you know, we see the pushback for the people still savoring for those good old days where you put your head down when you hit a home run, and straight face, and don't look anyone in the eye, and do the thing, run around the bases. And but I think the other side is actually finally starting to win out, and people are starting to realize there's nothing wrong with having fun in the game. That said, if I could wander it, I'm wandering the economy. If I've got my magic wand, as much as I'm frustrated by the fun stuff in baseball, I just think the economy, where you've got, you know, and this remains true to this day, where you take a look at the top contracts in baseball, the top 10 guys making the most amount of money are
worth less than players at the bottom of the list who are making no money, but they're these young guys who are extraordinarily valuable, who are getting totally screwed by the system in that way. So it's just like, it incentivizes tanking too much. Players don't get paid when they're valuable. Then now owners have figured out we had them while they were valuable and we weren't paying them. Now that they're 29, 30 years old, we're not going to pay them anymore because that's when they used to make their money. And it's just an untenable situation. So yeah, if I could wave a magic wand and create the salary floor and fix the economy and disincentivize tanking and all the, make it so that you can trade draft picks. That's another thing that like really helps mid to lower market teams and other systems. Like Patrick was talking about, if you can't go out and sign the big free agent, then you've got to be able to draft them. And if you've got more bites at the apple of being able to draft people, if you could trade Trevor Story for draft picks, instead of having to figure out which guy can come back and offset this thing and do they have a player, just give me some draft picks and we'll take it from here. So those, I wish we could fix that, but it's harder too. It would require a magic wand.
It would. And I think for me, the biggest reason why I would wave that wand over the economy, as you said, is just to avoid the strike. Let's just avoid the strike. Like that's even the biggest piece. And because even if baseball doesn't figure out the fun stuff and you say, oh, look at how unfun baseball was 4 years ago. Okay. Well, it moved along and still existed 4 years later and right. It was fine. So baseball doesn't necessarily need to have that. Now, granted, right, their fan base is getting older and older and, you know, they're not bringing in those young fans. And so eventually it could be, you know, it could come to an end or something, but it's more likely to, if they can't figure out the economics of it, that is what will kill the sport. That is what will, you know, bring this whole thing, you know, down to its knees more than the fact that, oh, guys aren't really able to celebrate or they don't feel comfortable or we're not bringing in the best athletes because they're not having as much fun. That's a problem for sure. The economy is a much bigger issue. In this economy?
Patrick, that was so much fun. We didn't even really preview the homestand because, you know, the Rockies will play baseball this week.
The Rockies will be baseballing.
They'll be out there.
It's Rangers. David Dahl returns.
That's right. Except he's been hurt. Is he?
He's been a little banged up. He hasn't been playing too well. It's kind of the same old story.
We'll get to see him. And as we've talked about before, for whatever other issues, you know, guys always seem to really create a strong sense of family here. And so I'm sure Dahl will be really happy to see all the guys. He'll be in town. And so I forgot about it. Shout out to our guy, Julian, speaking of family. As of course, you know, Julian Valentin of the Colorado Rockies social media department on his way out after over 10 years going to spend some time with the little ones. Former Colorado Rapids professional soccer player, by the way, very interesting guy. I think we had him on. I had him on a very, very early edition of the BSN Rockies podcast back in the day.
See if you can find that, right? or do you not want that? Do you not want people to go back and listen to that?
With my old ass mic standing there in the old media room for 15 minutes. I don't even know if that's still available. Is that on the system? Anyway,
you have to listen to it on Zoom. In order to hear that one.
As most people know, the social media for the Rockies, everything else, you know, they've been fantastic. He's always had a great team there. People kind of in and out that have been helping him there for a long time. So we want to wish him the best. He's always been fantastic. Hope that the people have learned from him well and can continue on the tradition of fantastic at Rockies social media. They're two-time Goaties. They are two-time defending Goatee winners, was Julian. So we'll see
if this at Rockies. Yeah, he's the mastermind. Got to give it to him.
Yeah, really one of the best. And I think recognized as such throughout the sport too. And I think you see a lot of other Major League Baseball teams trying to emulate what he was able to successfully implement here. So really, truly one of the best. You got to tip your cap. You forget sometimes it really takes an army of people down there to make a Major League Baseball team go. And while certain parts of it may not always be functioning properly, some people can just stay in their lane and do their thing and achieve absolute excellence. And that was Julian. So
Rockies 4-2 victory tonight. Put in the books.
You got it.
4-2 victory.
With your guy hitting a home run too.
With Adolis Garcia.
Adolis Garcia.
And the Rockies are going to win the series.
Learn some of these American League names. Interleague play is always one of those ones where I'm reaching for the baseball reference. So, Adolis Garcia. All right.
28-year-old superstar.
Ready. So ready.
Out of nowhere.
This week, watch some baseball. Join us in some post-game chat. Spend some money on DraftKings Sportsbook. Drink a little Breck Brew, Strava Craft coffee, and a Hassle. Well, don't drink your Hassle Cattle Wagyu beef. You go ahead and eat on that. Chew your beef. It's important.
You can get that at the bar too.
That's right.
If you're like, hey, you know what? I'm not sure if I'm gonna like it. There you go. Come down to the DNVR bar, sample it there, and then you can order it right from the bar, right from your tabletop, because you're guaranteed to go gaga over that.
That's a great point. I've forgotten those hamburgers down at the bar. Whew, potentially life altering. Get in there, check it out, hang out with us all week watching baseball and just talking about baseball. We'll see how it goes. Like I said, they've been better at home. Patrick's calling a 4-2 W. Let's see how it goes against these teams. Follow everyone on social media at Drew Creasman, at Patrick D. Lyons, at DNVR_Rockies. Don't forget to follow Makayla E. Perkins, also doing fantastic work out there on the social, especially now that DNVR has got two teams in the playoffs that we're covering there. Make sure you're following along with all of that excitement as well. Subscribing to the DNVR.com for all the written content and all the discounts, and hang out in the Discord and all that fantastic stuff, and just being absolutely awesome baseball fans out there. We promise to be absolutely Patrick Lyons and Drew Creasman in here. And until next time, we will see you at the ballpark.